if I was to die today, you know, you can't save me. As much as you love me and my family loves me, no one can save me. The only one who can intercede for me and save me is Jesus. Hello friends, welcome back to Life Chat with me, Karima. I am so glad you're here. So today I'm going to share with you my testimony of how I met this amazing, loving God who loves me unconditionally and who has changed my life forever. So I was born in Morocco. I grew up in a Muslim home speaking Arabic. Our way of life and culture, it is very different than it is here for sure. I grew up watching my family pray 5 times a day. I watched my family do Ramadan, which is fasting from sunrise to sunset every day for 30 days. And then we had a big feast every night. I did not have to do Ramadan because I was young, but I sure enjoyed the feast. When you are born in Morocco, you are born into the religion of being a Muslim. You know, everything you do, you know, is centered around the Muslim religion. You know, it is who you are, it is your identity, you speak about it every day. You know, thankfully, I didn't have to practice, you know, and do Ramadan and prayers and things like that because I was a young child. But I did have to read the Quran in school and remember certain prayers. Matter of fact, I have one that's, you know, engraved in my head and I still remember, even though it's been 36 years that I left Morocco. My parents divorced when I was 2 years old and I lost my dad when I was 10. My mom met my wonderful stepdad who was French and we moved to France when I was 12 years old. France living is definitely very different than it was in Morocco. I mean, I grew up in a very conservative home in Morocco where you didn't even see, you know, a couple kiss or hold hands. You know, even in the movies, you know, you would see a romantic scene and two people would come really close and talk all romantic and stuff, and all of a sudden the scene would just stop. So I was definitely very sheltered, you know, as far as the outside and kind of see, you know, different things, you know, from other countries and things like that. We just didn't see a lot of stuff, you know. It was mainly just whatever was going on in our home, you know, as far as being a Muslim and our culture and things like that. Anyway, so in France, it was very different because when I showed up, it was like, whoa, you know, what a shock, you know. It's a very open country, and I mean, you see people half naked just in commercials, you know, so I was definitely in shock for sure. But the one thing that, you know, really got me was the fact that there was churches, you know, cathedrals all over France. In every village, there's a cathedral. But yet you don't never hear about God. You never hear about Jesus. You never hear about religion, you know. And in my house, you know, my mom, even though she was Muslim, she didn't really practice. And my stepdad, you know, I found out later he was actually Catholic, but he never practiced in front of me. So I grew up in a home, you know, with two different cultures, two different religions, and you know, there was just no unity there as far as the religion part of it. You know, you don't know which way to go. So as a child, it can be very confusing, you know. And I went up to my mom and I've asked her, you know, what should we do? You know, now I'm old enough, should I go ahead and start praying? Should I do the Ramadan? And she was like, you know, you're okay, you know, you're a good person, and as long as you're a good person, you'll go to heaven. And so I just believed her and went with that, you know, but I never really had peace, even though, you know, I believed my mom and I trusted my mom and I loved her. I just never had peace about that decision. I had never celebrated Christmas or Easter in Morocco. So when I moved to France, we celebrated both holidays. We had a tree, you know, my mom bought a tree, and there was this little house under the tree with a man and a woman and a baby and animals. And I thought, oh, that's so cute, you know. And then we had presents and I thought, oh, this is nice. I like this kind of holidays. And, you know, I didn't realize the whole time that the little house was the manger, and it was actually baby Jesus in there and Joseph and Mary. you know. And then Easter came and we did the egg hunt, and I got chocolate bunnies, and again I was super excited, but I was never told why we had Easter, you know. And so I was just excited to have those kind of holidays where you eat chocolate and get gifts, because we didn't have those in Morocco. You know, we have two holidays in Morocco. And we have the first one is called Eid Sghir, which is the small holiday. And it is a celebration after Ramadan. It's a big feast, you know, and you all just sit down with your family and have a big feast. And then the second holiday, it's called Eid Kabir, which is the big holiday. And that's when we sacrifice a ram. You know, my grandparents would, and you know, my family would buy a sheep, and we'll have him for a couple of weeks in the house. And I make friends with the sheep, and I think, you know, he's a pet. And then the next thing you know, he's gone, you know. But my, you know, my family would call the butcher on the day of the holiday, and he would come to the house. You know, everything is style, obviously. But he would come to the house, and he would put that sheep right in the center of the house, and that's it. He's gone, you know. And that's the sacrifice they did every year to celebrate that holiday. So there was no chocolate bunnies or presents in our, you know, holidays. At age 18, I was given the opportunity to come to the U.S. and work. Unfortunately, I found myself in a very abusive marriage. I was young and naive, and like many nights, I found myself on the couch one night crying, thinking, you know, what just happened to me? Why am I here? You know, why is this happening? But there was this sermon on TV. This man was preaching, and he was at the end of his sermon, and he said, "Bow your head, close your eyes, and pray with me." And you know, I just remember I was so desperate, you know, to just find answers for myself, for my life, for what was going on in my life at the time. You know, I didn't have any family here, I didn't speak the language, and I was very lost. And so I prayed with him, and I think that was one of the first seed that God planted in my heart, you know, as a Christian. Nothing came out of that right away, obviously, over time, I left that marriage, and I was able to get away from that, which I'm going to do a video on that. I'm going to share my whole story about my five-year marriage that I had, where I was abused and how I overcame it. I believe that it's going to be very helpful to many women out there who feel trapped in the same situation I was in. But thankfully, I was able to leave that the situation. After I got divorced, though, even though as the years went by and I had a job and I had a car and I had my own place, I still felt lost. I would wake up in the morning and go, what am I doing here? You know, what is my purpose? Like, I couldn't understand why I felt the way I felt. I just had no peace whatsoever, you know? But God had a plan, you know, all along. Everything that went through, everything that, you know, that happened to me, He had a plan for me. As time went on, I had many people invite me to church, you know, over time, just everybody is like, hey, come on to our church. And like, no, I'm good, thank you, you know. And in my mind, I'm thinking, no way I'm going to their church, you know. I would be betraying Allah and my family, and I just can't do that. You know, so I was really scared to even put my feet in a church building. In 2001, I met my wonderful husband of 19 years, and he invited me to his church. And I went with him. You know, I thought about it, and I said, you know, I'll go, I'll try it out. And so I went in, and I don't know what happened. I was sitting there listening to the sermon, listening to the preacher, and this feeling that I have never felt in my life came over me. And it was just such peace. I felt like I was on a cloud, you know? It was just so peaceful. I felt so good. And I remember leaving the church that day, and I'm like, what was that about? You know, what was that? You know, and so I just started going back, you know, to church with him every Sunday. And eventually he proposed to me, and we went to see the pastor of that church. He was a good friend of my husband, and he said, "Hey, would you mind marrying us?" And he said, "Well, you know, which religion is she?" And he's like, "Well, she's Muslim." And he's like, "I'm sorry, I can't marry you. She would have to be a Christian." And we were both in shock. We're like, "What? What do you mean you can't marry us?" You know. But so we went home, and my husband was at the time, obviously he was my fiance, but at the time he was like, "You know what? You don't have to become a Christian because of me. I love you, and no matter what, I'm gonna marry you. So, you know, don't feel pressure to become a Christian because he's saying you need to be a Christian." And so I'm like, in my mind, I'm thinking, no worries there, you know. But over time, you know, I just started thinking about all the things that happened to me in the past, and you know, all the people who've planted seeds in my life, you know, and I was like, you know, maybe I need to do this, you know. And so I went to work the next day, and I had a really good friend of mine who was a Christian, a very good Christian woman. And I talked to her about what happened. She said, "Karima, you know, it looks like God is after you. You know, he's been after you for a long time." And, you know, I said, "You know, maybe you're right." So I went home, and my husband prayed for me, and so I decided to give my life to Christ, and it's the best thing I've ever done in my life. It's been 19 years now since I became a Christian, and I wouldn't change it for the world. Now, when I just became a Christian, I had to tell my family the big news. The first person I wanted to tell was my parents, and so I told my mom about it, and she said, no, you cannot be a Christian, you're Moroccan. And I said, "Mom," I said, "being a Moroccan and be a Christian is two different things." She's like, no, you're Moroccan, you're Muslim, that's it. I said, being Moroccan, it's my origin. It's where I, you know, I was born Moroccan, you know. But, you know, being a Muslim it's a religion. You know, it's okay for me to change my religion. If I feel that Christianity is the right way to go, it's okay to do that. And you know, she didn't really understand it at first, you know, and I didn't really know how to explain it to her because, to be honest, I was, you know, I was a new Christian. But after thinking about it and praying about it, you know, I told her, I said, "Mom," I said, "listen, I love you and I love my family. And, you know, I will always be a Moroccan." But I said, you know, if I was to die today, you know, you can't save me. As much as you love me and my family loves me, no one can save me. The only one who can intercede for me and save me is Jesus. You know, and I believe in him. I believe that he came and he died for me. I believe that he came to save me from my sins. And, you know, I said, you know, it's my choice. You know, I can't say no to him because you want me to. You know, and I just felt like it was an individual choice. And for a long time, to be honest, I thought it was a family thing. I thought, okay, if my family is Muslim, I have to be Muslim. But no, it's not true. It's not true. You know, when you die and you're right there in front of God, you know, your parents, your family is not going to be there and say, "Oh, would you please let her in? You know, let him in." No, nobody can do that for you. It is an individual choice. You have to make that choice for yourself. And I finally understood that. And what I did in a loving way, I told my family about it, and eventually they accepted it, thankfully. I found a God who loves me unconditionally, and he loves you too. We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to follow a certain ritual. He loves us no matter what. All we have to do is believe. Remember that peace I was telling you about? I found it. I found that peace. I have it in my heart every day. I know where I'm going. I have purpose. You know, my life is not perfect. I am still a sinner in need of his grace every single day. But when I come through a problem or a struggle, he's there to carry me through that. He's there with me. You know, I can come to him every morning and read his word and get encouragement and get guidance from it. I pray that this testimony would be helpful to you. I pray that he planted a seed in your heart. And I pray that you find the truth for yourself. Don't believe what I say. Buy a Bible. Read it. You read it for yourself. And you find out the truth for yourself. It's there. Thank you so much for watching. Blessings to all and much love.